Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text this morning is a portion of the Holy Gospel, specifically verses 15 through 17, and also verses 21 and 22, which I'll read again for our hearing. As the people were in expectation, and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John, whether he might be the Christ, John answered them all, saying, I baptize you with water, but he who is mightier than I is coming, the strap of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. Now when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, the heavens were opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form, like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased. This is the word of our Lord given to us this day. Please be seated. My dearest brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, way back on January 1st, it seems such like a long time ago, doesn't it? We heard about the circumcision in name of Jesus. And we heard that the name of Jesus is so very important. His name actually means something. It means something to you and to me and to the whole world. God saves. Now we come forward in time. Jesus is now 30 years old. And today, the name of Jesus is given significance. Today, Jesus is anointed. Today, your Lord is given his most holy title, Christos, the Christ, the Messiah. Today, yes, today, you hear that Jesus is your Messiah. In the beginning of our gospel this morning, John is bearing witness of the one. He's bearing witness of the one who is to come, the one that he was proclaiming, and very soon that fulfillment would be standing before him. Yet the people were confused. The people thought that maybe John, just maybe John, was the promised Messiah. And John, this powerful preacher, he would condemn the Romans, and he would condemn Herod, and he would kick them all out, and the kingdom would be restored. Yet, John publicly pointed, not to himself, but he pointed to the one who was to come. John pointed out correctly that the Messiah would be more powerful than him because the Messiah, the Son of God, he is God. Therefore, he has divine power and glory. John, the servant of God, he's not even worthy to stoop down and untie the latch or the sandal of his Lord. That, my friends, was the duty of the lowest slave, to unlatch the sandal of their master. And John is telling us, he's not even worthy of the lowest duty of the lowest slave. Here we hear the humbleness of John the Baptist. Jesus pointed this out for us some years, about a year later. Jesus said, I tell you the truth. Among those who are born of woman, none is greater than John. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. The humbleness of John was rewarded. And yet you, his child, you are greater than the great John the Baptist. Yes, John, born of a woman, the one who is born among women, who would be the greatest. He would proclaim the coming Messiah. Yet you, because you are baptized, and because you are a Christian, because you are adopted into the kingdom, because you are His, as you heard from our readings this morning, you are also called great, even greater than John. Then John points to something that's very important for the world to hear. John points to the power of the Messiah, that He will baptize. He will baptize with the Holy Spirit and fire. Only Jesus would pour out the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. We hear this from Acts chapter 2. And those flames of fire, they represented something very important. That purifying fire. For you know, dear friends, that for a goldsmith to purify gold, he has to stick it into the fire. And then as the dross rises to the top, he takes the gold out and he pours off the dross. And then he sticks it back in again. And he pulls it out and pours off the dross. And he continues this purification process until it's pure gold. This is the refining process. This is the refining process, my dear friends, that you have undergone, as you just heard with the children. The refining process started right over there at the font. It started at your baptism. For there, in your baptism, you were baptized with the Holy Spirit and with fire, that purification that burns away the ungodliness that is in you, the unholiness, and makes you spiritually alive once again. Oh, it's true, we remain sinners, for we will always be sinners until the day that we die. Yet because of what Jesus has done for you in His baptism and there at that font, you are spiritually alive, and you are claimed to be His child, for He Himself washes you clean and purifies you, and God Himself claims you to be His own dear child. He adopts you into His kingdom. This purification process should not surprise us. Oh, you've heard it before in the Old Testament, and you've also heard of it in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, there was Isaiah standing before the throne of God, and then he writes, "Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, 'Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for. Behold, the word of God has been poured over you. Your guilt is taken away. Your sin has been atoned for.'" And then later, some 700 years later, Peter writes, "So that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." Yes, my dear friends, your faith is constantly being tested. Your faith is constantly being purified, refined. And this is done by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, those tongues of fire should always remind us, yes, of the Holy Spirit, but of that constant process of setting you apart, of sanctification, that keeps you in the one true faith until life and salvation. Then John lastly points to Jesus the Messiah as the judge. He describes threshing for us. And for our farmers, I don't think you would like this much. You would pile all of your reaped harvest onto a threshing floor, and you would have your donkey or horse or whatever, your oxen maybe, walk over it until the stalk is separated from the head of grain, and then you would bind up the stalks and throw them into the fire. Sound familiar? And then you would grab your threshing shovel or your threshing fork, and you would throw the grain up into the air, and the wind would blow away the chaff, and falling to the floor of the threshing floor would be the valuable grain. This is what John is describing today. Thank God for John Deere, right? But John is describing something that's even more thankful, that Jesus is the judge, and that he is the one who will separate the grain from the chaff. The chaff is that which is useless. It is empty. It is without Jesus. It's the unbeliever. And my friend, it may even be a person who says that they are a Christian, but they've never lived a Christian life. They are chaff. But the grain, you, the grain, you are valuable. You are full, for you have been baptized into Christ. And because you have been baptized into Christ, you are his dear child, and your sin is forgiven. Oh, it's true, we will always be sinners. You and I, we break the commandments daily. We break them much. We like to place ourselves above other people. We like to place ourselves above God himself. Yes, we sin against our neighbor in thought, word, and deed, as you just confessed. And we are worthy of death. We are worthy to be as the chaff thrown into the unquenchable fire. But God is merciful, and God is kind, and God is loving. And he sent his son, who walked into the water, and as that water was poured unto him, your sin was taken unto him, and he carried your sin and my sin and the sin of the whole world to his cross. Today, John correctly points out that he is unable to do this great work of the Messiah. There is only one. There is only one who could do this work. And his name is Jesus, God saves. He is the Messiah, the Christos, the Messiah. He comes. He comes to be baptized with the people. Yes, I know many times we have this thought or this concept in our minds that it's just John and Jesus there and no one else. That's not what Luke is telling us. Jesus walks out of the crowd and he walks into the water and he stands before John. We know the interchange in Matthew. Here there's no exchange of words. Luke, this correctly, very succinctly, tells us that Jesus is baptized. Yes, this pouring of water is necessary. The baptism of Jesus is necessary. It's necessary for him to take your sins into himself. It's necessary that he bear the sins of the world. It is necessary, my friends, that he redeem, that he pay the debt, that he pay your debt and my debt by his blood, by his death, so that you and I can live, so that we can stand before the Father fully justified by the blood of the Lamb. It's necessary. It's necessary for Jesus to be your Messiah. And then, suddenly the heavens are opened, and descending on him in bodily form as a dove, the Holy Spirit. Why would the Spirit descend on Jesus? My friends, as you may remember from the Old Testament, when the kings were anointed, they would bend their knee and they would have olive oil poured onto their head. That anointed them to be the king. Yet Jesus is anointed from on high. He is anointed by God himself. And in his human nature, he is strengthened by the power of the Holy Spirit to do the work that he is now about to do. So here, as the Holy Spirit lands on him, Jesus is anointed to be your Messiah and to be my Messiah. This is also necessary. My friends, behold my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. This was what was prophesied about this event there in the Jordan 700 years before the fact, as written by Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 42. Jesus fulfilled scripture perfectly, even to the point of walking into the water and being baptized. And lastly, my friends, lastly, but not, of course, least, is the voice of the Father. The Father approves. He says that you are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Yes, this identifies Jesus as the Son of God, the second person of the Holy Trinity. Here we have the Father present, and the Son present, and the Holy Spirit present. Here is the Trinity. How can you doubt that there even is a Trinity? For He Himself shows us that there is a Trinity. And Jesus is loved by His Father. For Jesus is the one who will fulfill the plan of the Father, the plan that God set in place at the very beginning. For Jesus is the one who will crush the head of the evil one, yet His heel will be bruised. That word, goodwill. That word, goodwill, is very important. You've heard that word before, haven't you? Way back on Christmas Eve, the children told you that the angels came and said, peace on earth and goodwill toward men, because God's goodwill had now come to men. God's goodwill is Jesus. Because Jesus is the one, God is now having goodwill placed in your midst, because it is Jesus who has come. He is the one who will suffer. He is the one who will die. He is the one who will rise. He is the one who will redeem. Jesus is the one who fulfills God's plan of salvation. My friends, He does this for you, and for you, and for you. There on the bloody cross, Jesus was numbered with the transgressors. Jesus came to fulfill every righteous demand of God. And then He joined us into His baptism, a baptism that each and every one of you have undergone in order to take your place. Yes, to take your place, to suffer what you deserve to suffer. Jesus took your punishment. He took it for you so that you may live. Therefore, my dear friends, in closing, at your baptism, may you always remember your baptism in the confession of your sins. Remember that you were buried with Christ Jesus, and that you have been raised to life and to salvation because of your Messiah's work. All your sins are forgiven, and you have been adopted. You have been made heirs of the kingdom of God, and this is not of yourself. It is of the work of God Himself. And because God has done this great work for you, He proclaims to you today, in you, I am well pleased. Thanks be to Jesus, your Messiah. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.